here, I'll be talking about this crack exploit, the key reinstallation attack. That's what crack stands for. And it just came out recently, so I'll be telling you everything you need to know about it. In fact, I'll tell you right now, my last line on my last slide says, don't panic. And that's really all you need to know about it. But here's some more details. So it was discovered by Matti von Ruf early this year and announced that it was announced to vendors much earlier, but it was announced to the larger public not very long ago, just a few weeks ago. It's actually a group of about 10 different security flaws, all related to each other with respect to Wi-Fi communication. Now, the common vulnerabilities and exposure, CVE numbers, are assigned to each vulnerability. And so this is actually numbers from 2017, 13077 through 13088. And they all have to do with what goes wrong inside of your laptop, as opposed to what goes wrong inside of the wireless access point. Except for one of them. One of them is a wireless access point vulnerability. And it's only for those rear access points that do 802.11R, something that apparently some businesses use, but you won't find generally around, and I can't tell you what the R version is. So, for background, you need a little bit of arithmetic. You need to know what the exclusive OR is. The exclusive OR is a mathematical function on zeros and ones, and we'll use a plus with a circle around it as the symbol for exclusive OR. You should know that it's both associative and commutative, whatever those mean. It means A or B or C is the same as A or B or C. That's the associative. And commutative, A or B is the same as B or A. You can reorder things. You can parenthesize them however you want. A few other important properties that any x, whether it's 0 or 1, or with x, gives you 0, and the 0 or exclusive OR with any x gives you x back. These are basic mathematical properties which turn out to be true. And so if you've got x exclusive OR y, let's call that z. Then what happens if you take z and exclusive OR with x? You get that y through this set of an algebra. Okay, I'll walk through it one because it's good to see it once. Z exclusive OR x, I'll just plug in for z what it is. That's x exclusive OR y. And then I'm reordering and putting the two x's next to each other, which I can do because of commutativity and associativity. The x or x becomes 0, and the 0 or y, the 0 disappears, and I get back the y. Right? So that's a nice property of exclusive OR. And in fact, it's used in RAID, which stands for Redundant Array of Independent Disks. In preparing for this, I had to look up all sorts of acronyms. And every acronym I use, I think I've defined at least the first time. So, redundant array of independent disks. What's that?
RAID.exol.
Yeah, exclusive OR. It is an acronym after all, isn't it? And OR is a recursive acronym standing for OR. Right. So anyway, let's say I've got disk blocks on two separate disks. I've got X and Y. What I can do is I can reserve a third disk to always be the bitwise exclusive OR of all the blocks on X and Y. Now, if Z should fail, no problem. That was just the backup disk. Rebuild it. Get a new disk and rebuild it. But if Y should fail, I can take the disk Z and exclusive OR with the disk X. I get back the original Y. And if X should fail, I can restore it. And so the idea here is that if a disk should fail, and disks always will eventually, it's the nature of disks. Never assume that your disk will last forever. When your disk fails, you can restore the data by buying a new disk and doing some arithmetic. So that's a nice property, which we won't use. What I will use is exclusive OR to build ciphers. Now, block ciphers, like the AES, the Advanced Encryption Standard, what they do is they take a key, and they take a block of data, and they do some arithmetic, or some manipulation, they give you back a new block. What AES does is it takes a block of 128 bits and it gives you 128 bits. And we'll be calling the input the plain text and the output ciphertext. These wires are just in my way here. All right. So how you can build a stream cipher. There are all sorts of ways of doing it, but here's one way. If you have a random set of bits, infinitely long as you might need, and they're random, by which I mean that every bit has equal probability of being a 0 or a 1, and they are serially independent. The fact that this is a 1 tells you nothing at all about the next bit, right? If I've got that, and I'll call it a pad, then I can exclusive OR it with my plain text. And the result, and the plain text can be however long it is, just a stream of bits. And I apply to that stream of bits a stream of pad. And what I get, then, the exclusive OR, is going to be my ciphertext. I'll use some abbreviations just for convenience. The plain text I'll call P, ciphertext C. The pad I'll call S for stream, because I was using P for something else. Then the ciphertext, which I build by just exclusive ORing, bitwise, the pad and the pad and the plain text, that's going to be random. In fact, you can't look at it and see anything that tells you anything at all about the plain text, because there's enough, you have a random pad, and exclusive OR happens to have this nice property that you can't, it'll be equally probable 0 and 1, no matter what your original text was. Even if the original text was all zeros, the output will be random zeros and ones. Even if the original text was all ones, it'll look like random zeros and ones. You get no information at all. That's kind of nice. So if an intruder tries to figure out the plain text by looking at the ciphertext, and hopefully the intruder only sees the ciphertext, the intruder can't figure out anything without knowing the pad, S. So that's important information. Now, the next important information is, how does encryption work in Wi-Fi, which stands for, what does Wi-Fi stand for anyway? Wireless Fidelity? I don't know, what is the FI?
It does not stand for anything. It is made up to sound cool.
Okay, it's a cool sounding word. Great. Thank you. So there's a client, typically your laptop, and there's an access point, and I'm going to call them by their formal names. The client I'll call the supplicant, and the access point I'll call the authenticator. And once everything is set up, everything the Wi-Fi client sends, it's plain text that it wants to send out through the network. On the way between the client and the access point, it encrypts it, so people listening in can't hear. And of course, the radio, anyone can listen into. And so you want to make sure that people who are listening in cannot tell what's happening on that particular link in the entire communication. And so what the supplicant sends is a ciphertext, which is a stream, exclusive OR with a plain text. And the access point also knows the same stream. We'll see how that loops out. And then it computes the stream exclusive OR with the ciphertext, gets back the plain text, which then the access point does something with. It sends it along wires, and we don't worry after that who's listening in, because people can't listen into wires, we'll get back to that problem. We're only worried about that first link between the access point up there in the ceiling and the laptop here. So if the intruder knows the plain text, of course, the intruder can derive the pad, and that can be bad. If the supplicant should ever reuse a piece of the pad out of laziness, well, the new message is related to the previous one. So an example, let's say I've got a plain text 1 and a plain text 2, but as a foolish sender, I encrypt them by using the same pad. I have now C1 and C2. Now the intruder, realizing maybe, or guessing that I've done that, doesn't know what S is, but does know what C1 and C2 are, because you can listen in on that. You can do exclusive OR of C1 and C2, and it turns out mathematically, you can see it yourself here, that that reduces the P1 exclusive OR P2. Now, if the intruder can guess what P1 is, for example, it's a standard beginning of a conversation. There's a standard way you talk to a mail server, a standard way you talk to a web server. There's a protocol, and these are well-known protocols. So if the intruder can guess what one of those messages might be, Then the intruder can calculate what the other one is by knowing C1 and C2 exclusive OR. An exclusive OR, the guess for P1, I can get P2, and I can look at it and say, oh yeah, that really looks like a message. I have not broken the encryption. Therefore, the supplicant must never reuse any piece of the pad. It's got to be a one-time pad. In order for this encryption to be good, you must never reuse the pad. Yeah.
If I know P1, then can I, that first equation, C1 equals S, XOR P1?
Yes.
Could I XOR both sides with P1 to get?
You could get S, but that S was only good for that piece of message. And for the next message, it'll be a different piece of S, a different segment of S, and it will do you no good. That's right. Unless someone reuses it. And that's exactly why you should never allow those to be reused. All right, so there's a protocol involved, and I have to tell you the protocol before I can show you how it's broken. You've seen enough of the background of the mathematics, but how does the protocol work? This WPA2, the Wi-Fi Protected Access Version 2 protocol, it was designed only about 15 years ago. It replaced the wired equivalent privacy, which was only a few years older, but was deprecated because it turned out to be easy to crack. And since then, it's been very secure until this year. And it has to do with how we generate the S, the pad. Now, clearly, the supplicant and the authenticator have got to agree on the pad. How do they go about doing that? Well, I'll show you on the next slide, but first, I'll just tell you that they do agree on a PTK, a pairwise transient key, which is pretty long, 64 bytes, using a protocol that I will show you. And it contains within it 16 bytes of the temporal encryption key, that's part of that, and the supplicant has a sequence number, which is 16 bytes long, which is enough to hold 2 to the 128 numbers, you're never gonna run out of that. That's the sequence number, it starts at zero. And the way you build, then, this pad is by using that TEK, and you use it as the key for the AES encryption scheme, and you encrypt the next sequence number. And this method is called counter mode. And so you need another 128 bits of pad, encrypt the next sequence number. You need the next, add one to the sequence number, encrypt that. And as long as no one else knows what your key is, and the key is TEK, that key, and hopefully that was generated in a way that no one else can figure it out except for the two parties involved. No one can figure out anything about this one-time pad. It looks as if it is serial independent, 0-1 equal probability. In fact, it's pseudo-random, but it looks good enough. That's the idea. And so, the only thing that keeps changing is that M. Therefore, the supplicant must never reuse M. If you use sequence number 0, you should never reuse it. If you use sequence number 1, you should never reuse it. The crack attack convinces the supplicant to go back to 0. All right. How does that happen? Yes.
I have a question on the previous slide.
Yes.
So it still sounds to me like they're communicating the tech openly.
No. The tech is never transmitted, and I'll show you how it's devised. Yes, if you transmit the tech in an open way, then any listener can figure that out, can extract, can figure out exactly what you're doing. You must be sure that the intruder never can figure out the tech. Right. We'll see the technology behind the tech right now. So this protocol is known as the EAPOL, which I abbreviated as an extensible authentication protocol over a local area network. All right. It's a four-way handshake, and people usually call it the four-way handshake. They don't call it the EAPOL, but that's what it is. There is initially a dialogue between, it has a bunch of messages between the laptop and the access point. That's not important for our purposes. They've started to talk to each other. Now, what happens is four messages numbered 1, 2, 3, and 4. And the first message, this arrow means, I'm looking at it from the point of view of the supplicant. So it's a message coming in to me from the access point, from the authenticator. And it's a nonce sub A, sub authenticator. What a nonce is a random looking set of bits, which is generated by some random number or pseudo random number generator, and you just have to trust that it's never reused. Nonce means it's used exactly once and then thrown away. And so the access point invents a 32-bit random number and sends it as message one. Anyone who can listen can hear that number, right? The supplicant generates its own nonce, the nonce sub S for the supplicant, also 32 bits, bytes rather, random. These numbers I'm pretty sure of, but I had to look at all sorts of places to get the sizes of things, and I'm not sure of all of my numbers, but I think this is right. And now the supplicant has enough information to compute the PTK, this 128 or however the 64 byte thing. And how does it do that? It uses the two nonces, the one it generated and the one that it heard. It also uses the MAC addresses, which are the media access control addresses, which every device has, of it and of the other guy. And it uses the pre-shared key, because there is some sort of a hidden key that that you have to type into your laptop to agree to the wireless access point. All of those things are mushed together by an algorithm I wasn't able to find, and it creates this PTK. And the PTK, again, is 64 bytes long, part of which is going to be used as the key that I'll actually use. Now, anyone listening in can't do that. Why not? The person listening in doesn't even know nonce sub S. Well, they will soon, because message two is I will send back upwards the nonce sub S and a message integrity code just to make sure that the guy who listens can say, yeah, that's valid. I'm not going to talk about these message integrity codes again, but they're throughout the protocol. So anyone listening in knows the two nonces, knows the two MAC addresses, does not know that secret. And so no one listening in can do the same computation that both ends can do. What they can do is they can compute this PTK, and any time there's a new connection, it'll be a new PTK, because there'll be new nonces flying back and forth, and nonces never reused. Which means even if someone breaks my communication today, they won't break it tomorrow, because it's a new communication, a new connection, and there'll be new nonces, a new PTK. Question?
Which ingredient did you say they're missing?
What they're missing is the PSK, the pre-shared key.
So how do you get the pre-shared key?
That is done out of band. Someone tells you or puts it on a slip of paper saying, if you want to log into this, here's my password on my access point.
Oh, like the Wi-Fi password?
It's the Wi-Fi password.
So the attacker has the Wi-Fi.
Oh, yeah, anyone who has the Wi-Fi password can listen in on this and can break it. Yes.
I can listen to the communications of everyone on my Wi-Fi network.
If there's
not HTTPS or whatever.
I'm not sure of the answer, but I believe the answer is yes.
Oh.
Yes.
You can go to Starbucks and do this.
Okay. The answer is yes. Two people say so. So it must be true. What I tell you three times is true. All right. So anyway, message two now. The supplicant sends its nonce, and now the authenticator can do the same thing. It also can compute the PTK. And then we're ready to start sending messages. Well, there's an acknowledgement and some other stuff, which is not relevant, which comes in message three from the access point down to you, which says, okay, we're fine, go ahead. At that point, the supplicant sets its value of the sequence number n to zero and starts sending traffic. Oh, it also sends an acknowledgement saying, yeah, everything's fine, right? And that's the idea. The supplicant now can start sending encrypted data messages. The authenticator can decrypt them. Intruders are unable to do anything except. Now, here's part of the exploit. It requires the intruder be a man in the middle. This term was invented before women ever tried doing this. So it's called man in the middle, I'm sorry. And the intruder now uses a radio that advertises the same access code, the network name, the extended service set identifier, like EduRoam. It advertises the same one as the authenticator's real one, but it uses a different band. There are many different possible bands, and on a different slide I talk about what bands there are. And the supplicant then, instead of connecting to the real guy, connects, because maybe it's a better signal or it's closer by, connects to the wrong guy, to the intruder. And the intruder then connects on the original band to the real access point. Now an intruder sitting in the middle has several interesting abilities. The intruder can just pass packets along unchanged. Every packet I get, I can send on the other radio channel. And then the access point thinks that it's coming directly from a laptop. Or it can prevent a packet from getting through. It can hear a packet and decide not to send it along. It can also replay a packet. That's not going to happen in our case, but it can hear a packet and a few minutes later send it again. That's what a man in the middle can do. So now finally the attack. Message 4 is blocked. What was message 4? That was that final acknowledgement. Here it is, message 4. Now what happens if message 4 never comes through? The access point is waiting for it and doesn't hear it. Well, as is traditional in all these protocols, if you don't hear something, you assume that it got lost, but you don't know whether it's message 4 that got lost or message 3 that got lost. So you resend message 3. And message 3 is an acknowledgement. And so what happens is the authenticator resends message 3 after a bit of a delay, hoping the message will come through. And it's typically about 1 second delay. And the supplicant, the buggy supplicant, resets its end to 0. Oops. And it resends message 4, the acknowledgement, saying, yeah, everything's fine. But it continues to send encrypted data messages, reusing about 1 second of pad. That's bad news. The intruder now can have collected those previous messages, can collect the new messages, and can do arithmetic on them. In fact, the intruder can repeatedly block message 4, causing multiple resets of the sequence counter. At some point, they give up and they restart the whole communication. But for a while, you can keep doing this. You can get a bunch of packets, several bunches of packets using the same stream, the same pad. Now, if you can guess any of those messages, like you think, oh, that's a connection to a web server, then you can derive that piece of the pad. And therefore, you can read all the messages that are encrypted by that same part of pad. You can even insert a new message encrypted by that piece of pad. And it turns out that for reasons I wasn't able to find out, it can actually force the client into choosing a bad TEK. So I don't know how that works, but apparently it's possible by inserting stuff. On some implementations of this, and every manufacturer has a different implementation, but on the implementation on the Android, for example, it's possible for the intruder to convince the both sides of the communication that the TEK, that the encryption key, is 0. Well, now I know the encryption key. I can read everything. Now, in practice, the intruder, it's not all that easy. You've got to interpose this man in the middle. You've got to fake the MAC address of their supplicant. And, okay, there are... And you've got to use a different channel. There are 14 channels in one band and about 20 in the other band. Depending on what country you're in, you might or may not be able to use all of those. In America, you can only use 11 channels in the 2.4 gigahertz band. And in Canada, you can get one more channel, but you have to lower the power on it. Anyway, there are a bunch of channels there. Usually you can find a channel that's available. You've got to be pretty close. And therefore, if you're sitting at home, the chances are very good that there's no bad guy very close who's going to break in. But if you're sitting in a business office, in a bank, well, that's something that people might want to break into. So you have to be more careful if you're sitting in a bank. And the intruder can only run this when the supplicant is doing the connection. It's the connection protocol. Once the protocol's been set up, you can't break into it anymore. Well, you can, of course, by sending a deauthenticate message to the supplicant, you can tell the supplicant, we need to redo this. So, in fact, that's not a problem for the intruder. What do you do to fix it? Well, what the supplicant should do is not reset N. It should still reset the ACK. But it should not reset its N. It should just keep N where it was, keep advancing it. That's the fix. Now, it requires, of course, that all the supplicants have better software. You gotta have an upgrade of your software. Well, I have upgraded my laptop. I did it the very same day. I have not upgraded my Android because it's not ready. They haven't given me one yet. I gotta be more careful. Authenticators can mitigate the problem by, if they don't hear message 4, instead of sending message 3 again, they can say, let's start over, deauthenticate. Now that's problematic because it causes things to break and you've got to restart them. So that's a mitigation, it's not really a good long-term fix. Meanwhile, what users should do is they should always apply end-to-end encryption if what they're sending is important, like social security numbers, talking to your bank, whatever it is. So don't depend upon that WPA2 between you and the access point. Instead, only connect your browser to sites using the hypertext transfer protocol that's secure. And in fact, you should verify that you actually get that lock symbol, because I've seen online a demo where they were able to break into the communication so much that they could make it look as if you had connected securely, but in fact you were talking to HTTP and not HTTPS. So check the symbol, make sure it's really working. Use an end-to-end encryption like TLS or SSL, Transport Layer Security or Secure Sockets Layer. There's a whole library available for that, OpenSSL. You can use the SSH program. By the way, don't use SSL. TLS 1.2 is great. 1.0 and 1.1 are not quite as good. Web browsers, when they're talking to servers, negotiate. And they try to find the most secure security layer that they both agree on. And our web server accepts TLS 1, 1.1, and 1.2, and you will not accept SSL at all. You can check out your own server. Here's a website where you can do that from. I just did it today to check out our website. And Firefox and Android and Chrome, they all accept the best one. So that's what you should be using. Manufacturers are patching their software slowly. Yeah. Yeah, if you go to this website, they've got various ways you can test things. You can test any web server and see how secure that web server is. Test your bank's web server. I've done that. I sent messages to my bank saying, you know, you really ought to upgrade something. All these slides will be available on the Keeping Current webpage. I built these slides a new way, by the way. Can you see how I built them? I used Markdown and Pandoc, turning Markdown into Beamer slides. Anyway, so Linux was updated as soon as you needed it. Microsoft had actually released updates a bit before. Apple has been rolling out updates, but Apple software, it turns out their implementation wasn't so bad. Android, most have not been updated. Many devices, there's no easy way to apply an update. How do you update your router? It's not all that easy. And your toaster is vulnerable. And there is actually an Internet of Things. I don't like Internet of Things. It's so risky. I don't want my toaster on the Internet because someone out there is going to blow up my house.
Well, you can put a very big slice of bread.
You're right. And so here are the take-home messages. We're out of time, so I'll go through these quickly. One is the basic tenet of security. Don't trust an algorithm unless it's been around for a long time and smart people haven't broken it yet. So now we have to restart the clock on WPA2. Flaws, they keep being found. Don't expect that anything that is around now is without flaws. They just haven't been found yet. But usually there are good updates. You have to balance your need for security against your need for ease. I still want to use my laptop, even if it is. I'm using my phone anyhow, and I'm not connecting to my bank with my phone. And don't panic. If there are any questions, we'll take them offline because I'm already over by a minute. I will see you next week.